Hi friends, I was supposed to keep this method secret, however, your plants will thank me, will definitely thrive if you apply this method. Let me show you how you can make a steady releasing CO2 system that's safe for your fish and won't generate any algae. Let's get started. Here are all the materials that you need to make a system for yourself. You need two plastic bottles, a big one and a smaller one, some air tubing, if possible, the special one for carbon dioxide. And you need a CO2 diffuser. That's all. I personally like this Tropica 3-in-1 because it works with lower pressure. But you can also use these acrylic ones. I might even choose this tiny one. It is more discreet and I will be able to hide it inside of a nano tank. Also, the bottle from carbonated drinks are better for the job, and the bigger ones needs to be at least 2 liters, 2.5 it's even better.
You will find out soon why 2.5.
Speaking of pressure, here I have some other things that are not mandatory but will make your job easier, like this pressure gauge and some special caps that fits right on the bottle. Despite having many professional CO2 systems, I also used this do-it-yourself one over the years and I had great result. For instance, I have to move away this nano tank, so where I'm going to place it
will be too far away from my professional CO2 system, so this sugar and yeast generator will come in handy because it is
very mobile. Yes, it also has some downsides compared to a professional system that I will cover in this video, but at least it doesn't cost a fortune. And it's very easy to make one, just follow a few steps.
We'll do the composition now, and you will find out my secret ingredients that makes this constant and long lasting. It's an important step, so you better take notes.
Beside the water and sugar, we also have two more special ingredients, gelatin and baking soda. Here are the quantities. Feel free to pause the video if needed.
First, to avoid gelatin from clumping up, soak it into a cup of cold water. Don't use it directly in the hot pan.
Then, we'll drop our sugar and some warm water into a pan or a kettle. To dissolve the sugar, we need to warm the water even more and to stir well. Now is the time to add 1 teaspoon of baking soda and mix it well. It will protect our yeast from the acidity generated by the fermentation, so it will extend the life of our cocktail.
Our gelatin goes inside the last one. Make sure the water doesn't boil or the gelatin will be destroyed in the process. After it's cooled out, we can pour our mix in the bottle and leave it overnight in the fridge. It will get a jelly consistency after a night or two. If you don't have special lids like this, I will show you how to make your own. The hole in the cap must be smaller than the air tubing, but we'll seal it anyway with some super glue or silicone.
You can do this with a sharp object, like a knife, or a hot screwdriver to melt a little hole inside the cap. I find this hot screwdriver to be the best method because the hole will have a perfect round shape. First, you want a small section of tubing to connect the big bottle to the smaller one. To pass it through the hole, I prefer to cut it slightly diagonal and then to pull it with pliers or something like that. The end that goes in the big bottle must be quite short, 1 inch or 2 at most, because it has to stay in the air.
The other end of the tube that goes in the smaller bottle has to go all the way down. It will stay in water and will run the gas from our main bottle through the water to clean it. Why we need to clean it? Because the fermentation process can generate some foam, and that foam can end up in your fish tank. Foam also contains active yeast, and that is dangerous. I discovered these ones on Temu, and being a lazy person, I've bought a bunch of them. They are cheap and so is this one, and it gives us a nice feedback on the fermentation process. This is the way we are using those caps. The black tube will go on the bottom of the smaller bottle, the other black tube is connected to our diffuser. And this is the way to secure the connections. Just push your tube all the way over that bump, and then screw that nut tight. After everything is connected, what I like to do, just as an extra precaution but not mandatory, I like to tape those two bottles together for more stability. You probably noticed this system has no way to reduce our CO2 flow, our bubble count. This is why I haven't spoke about the yeast solution yet. To prepare the yeast, we need 2 cups of warm water and a teaspoon of yeast. That's about half of bag or 3 to 4 grams. To speed the yeast activation, you can add 1 or 2 teaspoons of sugar in this water as well. Otherwise, it will take over 24 or even 48 hours for your system to start generate CO2. If you use good quality yeast and gelatin, this will generate about 1 bubble each 2 or 3 seconds for about 6 weeks. If you add less or more yeast, at this moment, it will generate you a different amount of bubbles per second. For instance, with half teaspoon, you will only get a bubble every 5 or 6 seconds. But if you add a full bag of 7 grams or 2 teaspoons, you will get a flow of around 1 bubble per second. If it seems like it doesn't start, try to squeeze the bottle. You will feel the pressure rising. In time, the bottle gets harder and harder, and soon after will start producing CO2. If you're impatient, you can even give a gentle shake to your main bottle.
My recipe is for nano aquariums.
If you want to try it out, but you have a bigger tank, write me a comment with the tank size and other details. And I will help you to adjust the quantities to fit your need and to provide enough CO2, but not too much either.
Just like in professional CO2 systems, a drop checker is a must. You can see that my levels are okay, but stay out of dangerous zone, the yellow zone.
Even if your checker remain bluish or dark green, is still better than without any CO2 addition. As long as your CO2 levels are stable and not fluctuating, adding just a few is better than not adding at all, will still help your plants a bit. We'll color them up and will grow faster.
After the photo period, plants no longer produce oxygen. They even consume some of the oxygen produced during daytime. And that can be problematic,
especially if you have a huge plant mass like I do. It can lead to fish choking.
You can't turn it off at night. That's the biggest downside of the method. However, what you can do instead, improve your water circulation. Also, what you can do instead, if you're really paranoid,
Move your CO2 diffuser in a cup of water over the night, and by the morning you will have a nice cup of soda to drink. Just joking.
Make sure that you secure your generator. If it tips over, active yeast can end up in your tank and cause big problems. The small bottle protects only against foam, but if you accidentally knock it over, you should bring a replacement instead. Speaking of, it's quite easy to replace the main bottle if you make one in advance. The best moment is at the end of the photo period.
This way, if you're lucky, until the lights turn off, your CO2 will already start. Here is another DIY video of mine. Check it out if you need a gravel cleaner. If not, just put this one to good use and make yourself a nice CO2 generator.